Jesús del Alamo, a professor in electrical engineering at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, began work in the field more than 40 years ago. Things have obviously changed during that time, and now electronics are interwoven into almost every facet of our lives. So why is the United States only manufacturing 10% of the world's microchips? Del Alamo explains how we got here and what the Chips and Science Act means for the U.S. economy. I'm Dave Cantor, and this is The Best of Our Knowledge. You are Jesús del Alamo, professor in electrical engineering at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Thank you for joining me. A lot to talk about that kind of addresses huge portions of the economy and very recent actions by the Biden administration. But I think we should probably start off with basics and how we got to the place that we are. So I think the U.S. currently produces about 10% of microchips in the world. So how did we kind of wind up in the position that we're in?
Yes, Dave, thank you very much for having me in the program. I'm really delighted to be here to talk about these really very important and very current topics. Yeah, so we are, the U.S. is now producing about 10-11% of the microchips that are produced in the world. And clearly, this is way down from where it used to be. Just a few years ago, it was significantly beyond that. And in fact, the whole industry started in the United States in the 60s or so. So how has this happened? Well, the industry has been recognized to be extremely strategic by many countries and be a tremendous generator of wealth. And as a result, other countries have made a very high priority to nurture and support their own companies. And they have done so at a very significant level. So these companies have grown protected by the governments and helped by the governments. They have grown significantly. And in fact, the benefits that these governments, China, Taiwan, Korea, have extended to their own companies, they have also extended them to foreign companies so that they would set up shop in their own country. So as a result, U.S. companies have also set up fabrication facilities in Asia. And so altogether, this has meant that the current chip production in the United States has become, as you just said, about 10% of the world production.
Just so everyone is kind of on the same page, can you explain what, I guess, products that, you know, everyday Americans would be using that would have microchips in them? Like, what are those products? And can you explain why, since the pandemic, this has become kind of, sourcing these has become increasingly complicated?
So these chips are really everywhere. I mean, they are in cars, they are in consumer electronics, communication systems. In fact, you could think of your phone as a supercomputer. It does all kinds of amazing things, as we all know. It certainly is in all computers, medical devices, but also in very mundane and humble products like a doorknob that these days is connected to Wi-Fi, activates a camera and an image recognition system. Even a light bulb these days, it can change colors, it can change the intensity. They are incredibly efficient. So all this is possible through the use of microchips that are designed explicitly for all these functions. It also shows the tremendous capabilities of semiconductors to do all these different functions in all these different systems. So they're everywhere all around us. In many cases, we don't see them. They're very small. They're packaged. They're inside the box. But they're really performing extremely important functions that we couldn't do without anymore.
Well, so how have we wound up in a place where it's difficult for companies manufacturing stuff in the States? Why is it difficult for them to get them now?
This is the big COVID disruption that we have lived in the last 3 years. That was a terrible, tremendous disruption in how people worked, how people lived, where they were. And so as a result, that resulted in the car companies, for example, not selling cars, you know, this time because people were not commuting, they were not traveling. And as a result, they canceled many chip orders that they needed for their cars. And at the same time, there was an explosion of people buying all kinds of computers, communication devices, screens, entertainment devices, because, well, we were all stuck at home for many months, right? So there was a very big disruption in the market. Eventually, things turned around and people started to move around again. And then all this pent-up demand for cars materialized all of a sudden immediately. But now the car companies couldn't get their orders to be accepted by the chip makers because they were full making chips for all these other applications. And so it has been really a tremendous disruption at a point where, again, chips have entered everywhere. They're essential for many kinds of systems. And there is only so much capacity to go around. It takes easily 2, 3, 4 years since the planning of a new semiconductor manufacturing plant until it's fully operational. So it's very difficult to respond quickly to these big disruptions in demand.
Do you think this has impacted kind of the development of new technologies or other kind of other scientific endeavors since the pandemic started?
It's possible. I mean, we see the disruption, by the way, is much broader than just chips, right? I mean, there's a lack of all kinds of materials and systems. This has been a tremendous economic disruption in the world. And in the aggregate altogether, I am pretty sure that has also meant a disruption in the rate at which we have innovated. At the same time, you know, there has been tremendous incentives to continue to innovate in the area of microtronics and semiconductors because we have seen them to be so extremely important for our daily lives.
You mentioned subsidies ostensibly before and how other countries have kind of funded the manufacturing of chips. And President Biden just signed the Chips and Science Act. And part of the plan includes $52 billion in tax breaks for companies that manufacture semiconductors. So how big a deal is that? What does that number mean to you?
So first of all, a correction. The entire chips package is $52.7 billion. But the part of it that goes to provide incentives for semiconductor manufacturing operations in the U.S. is $39 billion. So the rest goes into fostering research and development, advanced prototyping, new manufacturing institutes, and fostering new technologies altogether. But the $39 billion goes to really encouraging semiconductor chip makers to set up operations in the U.S. And it's not a lot of money, but it is certainly a conceptual big deal in the U.S. because this is not the kind of thing that the U.S. generally does. The U.S. believes on a free and open and competitive marketplace and lets the market figure things out. But in this case, it has become very clear that the subsidies that other countries are offering to semiconductor makers to set up operations in their countries are so significant, they are so large, that unless we attempt to match that to some extent, well, we're just not going to be able to reshore semiconductor manufacturing in the U.S. So this $39 billion will go to some extent. It's not a lot of money because semiconductor manufacturing, I mean, it's a lot of money, but relatively speaking, semiconductor manufacturing is extremely expensive. So a new fab of the kind that are being announced these days by TSMC or by Intel or by Samsung costs easily $12, $15, $17 billion. So you can see how $39 billion is not a lot of money. It is calculated that it could support, maybe it could incentivize the setup of 8 new fabs in the U.S. as opposed to 0 otherwise. And so it would be of some significance, but it's you know, modest. This is something that probably will need to be sustained for years to come.
So I guess, how do you think the U.S. government's kind of performed in relation to this sector specifically? And has it made smart decisions to this point? Does this particular CHIPS Act does this change the game for anybody or no?
Well, it is a qualitative change in the game because the U.S. has never done anything like this, certainly not in this industry. So it represents a recognition that you have to work with the market in some way. You can't just let the market loose and things will turn out fine. You have to really actively engage in the case of such a strategic industry for the United States and for the world. And so it is a qualitative disruption in that sense, and it will have to be sustained going forward. This kind of engagement in the marketplace will have to be sustained if we want to have this key industry be healthy in the United States.
You mentioned the bill could potentially help 7 to 8 fabs start up. One of them is, I guess, going to be Micron, who kind of connected to this bill passing, announced that it was going to spend $40 billion on manufacturing and potentially create 40,000 jobs. Like, again, 7 to 8 factories seems like a lot, but also it's going to take X number of years to complete the building of all of those fabrication plants. So is this Micron announcement a significant portion of us kind of like moving in the right direction, I guess?
It is, definitely. I think it's very exciting that Micron is planning to set up to make such a large investment in manufacturing operations in the U.S. And I am sure setting this up in the U.S. is partly in response to the subsidies that the government is going to offer. And in fact, in the last few months, TSMC, Intel, Samsung, which are the three leading manufacturers in the world, have also made announcements of setting up significant facilities in the U.S. Intel has announced a potential total investment of $100 billion in fabs in Ohio, which is really huge. And so this is a total game changer if we can sustain it. And yes, you're right. It takes 3-4 years from the planning of a new fab to eventually coming into full production. So this investment needs to start now, and we will start seeing the returns a few years ahead. But then beyond that, we need to sustain this engagement.
So if it's going to take 3-4 years to complete any single one of these, and we already have a backlog of however many years as a result of the pandemic, are we kind of looking at shortages for almost a decade, I guess?
Well, there was a sense maybe last year that there might be shortages in the future for the reasons that you explained. On the other hand, just in the last few days and few weeks, things are starting to cool down because of this concern about inflation and perhaps a potential recession. And so we have seen some companies already making projections going on next year that perhaps their production is going to be lower than this year. So this is in some way, this is a cyclic business. It responds to global economic situation. And so we've gone through a very big peak as a result of COVID, but that resulted in the new fabs coming online and all fabs really going towards full-blown production. And so that has perhaps resulted in a bit of a capacity that could be corrected for the next year or two. So hopefully not. Hopefully these fabs will come online early enough for the shortage to be dissipated very soon.
I think in a lot of economic discussions, China has been set up to be an adversary, and specifically here. So can you kind of explain the relationship between manufacturing there and the United States, I guess?
Well, China has realized that this is an extremely strategic industry. So China is the foundry of the world, if you want, in so many kinds of products. And many of those products, as we talked at the beginning of this segment, have microchips embedded in them. And many of those microchips, about half of the world production of microchips, are actually designed by U.S. headquartered companies. They are sold by U.S. companies. So as a result, many of these products that China makes and sells in the world contain chips that are sold to them by U.S. companies. And therefore, they see themselves extremely vulnerable to potential conflict with the United States, as we have seen in the case of some of the 6G, 5G, and 6G technologies going forward. And so China has decided that they can't afford to have this vulnerability, and they want the chips that enter into the products that they sell to the world to be designed and fabricated in China. And so they are making enormous investments in setting up manufacturing plants, but also fostering local R&D so that they can get access to the most advanced technologies where the biggest profits are made, and also be able to also design many of their own chips as opposed to relying on U.S. designs.
So is this a national security issue? What problems might government and military stakeholders, I guess, see as a result of this?
There are very significant national security implications of all this. So on the one hand, the biggest production of the most advanced chips comes from Taiwan. And as we have seen just in the last few days, well, the relationship between Taiwan and China and also the engagement of the United States is very problematic and is tense. And there are concerns about whether that area could really ignite in some way in the future. And so with so much of the leading edge semiconductor manufacturing taking place in Taiwan, the disruption that that would produce would be enormous. Economic disruption, but also disruption to defense systems in the United States that rely also in many of those chips. And for China, and vice versa, we have the same problem. Many of the chips that enter into their systems are designed by United States companies. And so the U.S., as it has happened in the near past, can cut off the flow of those chips to China. We are seeing it happening today to Russia. And that has very significant implications for them, for their economy, but also for the national security.
Hey, just wanted to cut in here for a second and say that if you've got any questions, comments, or even ideas for future interviews, feel free to email me at knowledge@wamc.org or send us a message on Twitter. We're at tbookknowledge. That's T-B-O-O knowledge. How big of an issue is the labor market here and training that people would need? Because if there are zero fabs here right now, and we expect to employ thousands of people in jobs that previously have not existed, what's the timeline for training, I guess?
That's a very good question. Indeed, this is an industry that employs a lot of people. Altogether, about 280,000 jobs are in the semiconductor industry. About 185,000 are involved in semiconductor manufacturing in the United States. There's a whole side of design that I just mentioned the U.S. is really leading that involves a lot of people. And these are extremely well-paid jobs. So there is a strong interest, also from this point of view, of hosting as much semiconductor manufacturing in the U.S. because it generates a lot of very high, very well-paid employment. And it has a very large multiplicative factor. For every job in the semiconductor industry, there is as many as six other jobs through the U.S. economy. And yes, this expansion that we want to see, that the government wants to foster of semiconductor manufacturing in the U.S. is going to require a workforce that is very highly educated to do all the jobs that are required at many different levels. And that is a bottleneck. That's a bottleneck because, well, we've seen how over now many years, students with interest in STEM, science, technology, and math are really being attracted by more by computer science and artificial intelligence than hardware technologies like electrical engineering or mechanical engineering or material science. And so the number of students that are graduating from the programs, you know, in the aggregate in the United States is really not enough to satisfy this expansion that we want to see in the industry. So this is where universities come in also as a strategic element in this whole endeavor, which is to create educational programs that are attractive, that bring our students back, and that are also accommodate a bigger number of students and can make these students, when they graduate, to be more industry relevant, to join the industry and immediately become productive at whatever role they have to perform. So universities play a key role in this endeavor that the U.S. Government wants to get to, and that is why we are involved in many conversations and discussions, and we will be involved in many projects with industry.
What is MIT doing to prepare its programs or its current students for placement in the industry?
Well, we are trying to, as I said, start by attracting students back to the semiconductor disciplines, material science, electrical engineering, chemical engineering, etc. And one way to do that is to expose them to the excitement of these disciplines early on in their studies at MIT. So at MIT, the first year of our undergrad students, they do not have a declared major. They declare a major at the end of the first year or at the beginning of the second year. So the first year, the students belong to the whole university. And therefore, that is a key year for us to expose freshmen to the excitement, to the beauty, to the tremendous creative possibilities of these disciplines. So one of the things that we have done that I have personally been involved in is creating a freshman seminar where freshmen can enter our nanofabrication facilities and fabricate throughout the course of the first term, their first term at MIT. They're just freshmen at MIT. They can fabricate solar cells and be exposed to the process of silicon technology, the integration of different manufacturing steps, the design of solar cells, the operation of solar cells, eventually the testing of the solar cells, and then go around and do it one more time and see the various knobs that exist for improving the efficiency of solar cells. And the students have reacted really fabulously. This has been a tremendously inspiring experience. This really opens their eyes to what semiconductors do, what is nanotechnology, and how you can use these amazing instruments to fabricate these incredible devices, and how you can have it in your hands and see this being an eminently useful device that performs a society useful role, in this case, to generate electricity, something that we badly need to address our energy crisis. So these kinds of hands-on, exciting, stimulating, experiential educational opportunities is something that we see as being very effective to attract students back, and we are exploring educational experiences of this kind at MIT.
I think you mentioned the kind of high energy use related to creating both, I guess, the fabrication plants and then the products of the plants. So what kind of environmental impact is connected to manufacturing in this industry? And is there a kind of an ideal location for plants and for, I guess, universities to do further research?
A semiconductor fab is a very complex operation that requires a very rich ecosystem around it. So we said earlier how government incentives play a key role on the siting of a plant, perhaps as much as 30% in Asia of the total life operating costs of a plant are subsidized by the government through one way or another. So that clearly is a lot of money and determines to a great extent where a plant is going to be set up. But then, as you said, this plant is going to need inexpensive electricity, is going to need a lot of water, which should also be relatively inexpensive. It's going to need universities and an ecosystem of other companies that are going to support the operations of that plant. It's a very complex ecosystem that all comes together. And in many ways, the U.S. can be competitive in many of these aspects. But again, that 30% support of the setup of a plant when the cost is easily in the $15 billion range, you can see it's a significant amount of money. And that really is going to make the decision go in a certain direction.
Was there a connection between the plant in Columbus and Ohio State University, which I believe is one of the larger public schools in the country?
I would imagine so. I imagine that there is a number of factors, and one of them has to be the presence of a very strong university, Ohio State, very large and with capability to expand with very credible programs in this area. I am sure that was a very attractive aspect of the whole package.
Since the U.S. is ostensibly behind, even in thinking about setting up this kind of manufacturing here, what's the next evolution of this? Because if we're already ostensibly, you know, like 5 years behind other major centers of manufacturing, by the time we catch up, everyone else is going to be 5 years ahead of us. So what is the next step in this, do you think?
Yes, and this is where the other, $13 billion or so that we talked about at the beginning of the CHIPS Act come in. So the $39 billion are to really establish new manufacturing facilities in the United States and reshore semiconductor manufacturing here. The other $13 billion are really to accelerate semiconductor innovation and to accelerate the transfer, the transfer of new technologies into semiconductor manufacturing plants so that we can not just regain leadership, but then sustain the leadership as the technology continues to evolve very fast. So a big chunk of that money really goes to supporting new research and development, advanced prototyping, new engagements of universities and companies to focus on industry-relevant research and development and the accelerated transfer of technology to advanced manufacturing. And that, if we can execute correctly there, that could really be a significant accelerator for us to regain leadership.
So are these just different processes for manufacturing or more sustainable and simplified, I guess, processes?
Well, the industry is becoming extremely complex. The as you know, a lot has been said about Moore's law dying, which I think is an overstatement. I think it has been greatly exaggerated. I think Moore's law has a long way to go, and that Moore's law means the sort of continuous evolution, very fast evolution of electronics, of microelectronics in this direction that has been set for 60 years, in which transistors get smaller every time. We can put more transistors together on a chip, and as a result, we make chips that are more powerful while at the same time being cheaper. That is going to go on for a while. But for many new functionalities, for many new applications, we require more sophisticated and specialized technologies, for example, for electrical power management, for communications, for memory sensing. And so the need for innovation, it's continues to increase. We need to innovate new materials, new devices, new fabrication processes to be able to seize all these wonderful opportunities that are becoming possible as we learn more and as we develop more technology. So we need to continue to innovate across a very broad front. And that is what this legislation is also going to try to accomplish. There is, if you also think about it, there is the Chips and Science Act. We've talked about the chips part, which is $52.7 billion. The science part is $200 and some billion. And that is actually a much bigger investment at a more fundamental level, much earlier science level, to really investigate fundamental science that eventually would result in concepts that would be industry relevant and will then allow us to maintain that leadership for years to come.
Last one, and I'll let you go. Since this is a show about education, is there an interaction with a teacher or mentor that sticks out for you? And I realize also, I didn't mention this earlier, I believe you've been studying and teaching in this particular sector since the 70s, which I think is probably hard for some people to grasp since, you know, personal computing wasn't really kind of a mainstream thing until like the late 80s, early 90s.
You know, I feel tremendously privileged to have build my professional career in this field, because we have had, and I know it's going to continue, this unbelievable run, which is expressed as Moore's law, this doubling of the power of semiconductors every 2 years for now essentially 60 years. The full span of my career has been in this race, right, in which we saw year after year new technology coming out with new capabilities, enabling all kinds of new systems that people could really appreciate and use and benefit from. And it's just fun to reflect back of, you know, the first cell phone, or before that, the first personal computer and so on, and see how far things have come within just one lifetime, one, in my case, my professional career. So it's been exhilarating, and I am thrilled to see that this is going to go on for a while. It keeps changing, it keeps morphing it. But innovation, engagement of new materials, figuring out new physics that we can harness using nanotechnology, the potential is there. And it's just the future is just so bright. I want to share this enthusiasm with young students and have them take a look at this tremendous industry and these disciplines, where they can have, just like I have had, very long and fulfilling careers for years to come.
That's all we've got for this edition of the show. I'm the host and producer of The Best of Our Knowledge, Dave Cantor, and our theme music, this and every week, is a track called Musical Chairs by LA producer Omid Valizadeh. A link to his SoundCloud page is in the show notes. You can find The Best of Our Knowledge online at wamc.org and on just about any app you can think of: Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Pocket Casts. So go ahead, subscribe, and join us next week for another edition of The Best of Our Knowledge.